barn of sparrows.
This is an extremely happy barn, which we just sit here and you listen to the horses eating hay. And it's kind of shuffling around, and Yvonne's hanging out here, and you know, nobody's cribbing, nobody's stall walking, nobody's pawing, nobody's fighting with the horse next to them. These are just some of the happiest, most well-adjusted horses on the planet. We've had vets in here, Dr. Stephen Purdy. And the first time he was in here, he was just like, this is just the happiest barn I've ever been in. You know, like, all the horses are just so chill. They're just happy to be here. An unhappy horse, like in this situation, he's a happy horse, but would be, you know, exhibiting some of the stereotypic neurotic behaviors that you sometimes see, like for instance in caged zoo animals, which is basically what horse people call stable vices. Things like stall walking, which is weaving, which is sort of the back and forth, you know, cribbing, which is chewing on things, pawing, just generally being somewhat destructive around the stable. You know, this is a relaxed horse here. You know, her ears are forward, she's listening downstairs at what's going on. But she's not like all really upset. I mean, you see like how relaxed her lower lip is, and you know, she was shifting her weight. We saw her at Neil's barn, and you'll see at this stable, and at the other stables as well, 38th Street and on 48th Street. Our horses can see around all the sides of the stall. So Yvonne here can see her neighbors. She can see her neighbors over here. She can see the, she pretty much can see almost every horse, you know, on the floor. And so they very much feel like, you know, they. Ideally, we would sell the horses to other commercial carriage companies because that's what they're best at, that's what they're trained for, and that's what they have the most value as. Because a horse that can work in New York City, you know, is a valuable horse. However, NYCLASS doesn't want us to do that, all right? They want to pass a law that would say that any horse that's in the business currently could only be given or sold to either an approved sanctuary or private home that promises to never use the horse as a commercial carriage horse ever again or as a workhorse ever again. Now, the administrative code of the city of New York, which this law would be placed into, defines work as any time the horse is being ridden or driven or is wearing harness or saddles. So that would mean that these horses could only be used as companion animals. That's in fact what the law says, that these horses could only be used as companion animals. In other words, they could only stand in a field and eat grass and drop manure for the rest of their lives. Basically,
would that break their hearts?
That would depress the hell out of a lot of these horses. Our horses are special horses in that they have a certain type of temperament that makes them able to do this job and enjoy doing this job. They're very people-oriented. They want to have a job. They want to please people. Draft horses and draft horse crosses are kind of like the golden retrievers of the horse world. You know, they want to be around people and have a routine. And horses in general, all horses like having a routine. So as the animal rights people say, they put them in these tiny little jail cells, okay? That's not how the horse sees it. The horse has never watched movies about Al Capone and Alcatraz. You know, like, you know, they don't see this as a prison. What they see this as is they get to be close to all their buddies, they can see them all, they can even touch them through the bars, but you know what? Nobody can really eat their hay. You know, they have their own hay, they have their own space, they can lie down without somebody coming over and chasing them out, because in a herd situation, it is a hierarchy. NYCLASS claims that with the help of the ASPCA, they have lined up a waiting list of people to take our horses and give them homes. Now, that's nonsense because not every home is suitable for every horse, so you can't just plug and play, you know, any horse going to any home. So the idea that they somehow have all the homes lined up without even knowing anything about all of our horses shows that they know nothing about horses, never mind the fact they're not their horses to begin with. My fear, because we're dealing with PETA here too, I mean, they say, oh, the ASPCA is helping us home horses. They're also a partner organization with PETA, is I could very well see them finding out that homing 200 horses is a lot harder than it sounds. People who say, oh, I'll take a horse, have no idea how much it actually is going to cost them when they actually say, well, can you afford the $500 or $600 a month in rent, a board or whatever, or even more depending on where they're trying to keep the horse. Can you afford the farrier work? Can you find a farrier that's going to work on a draft horse? Because a lot of farriers won't work on draft horses because they want to spare their backs. Do you have a vet? All these things. And what's your income like? You know, it's my fear that when it becomes hard to home these horses, or they home with people and it immediately doesn't work out because the horse doesn't get along with the other horses, or they don't have the resources or the ability to take care of the horse, or the horse isn't happy because he's no longer working, that these folks will say, well, these poor horses have been so abused and have lived such a hard, miserable existence in New York, the only kind thing to do for them is to euthanize them, is to put them down so that they don't have to suffer anymore. Because that is what PETA does. PETA euthanizes in excess of 90% of the healthy animals that they take in every year. They are not a shelter, but people give them their animals thinking they're going to be home with them in Norfolk, Virginia, and then they turn around and they kill them.